please stand with me and we'll get started today. Aaron, will you lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ryan, will you pray for us, please?
God, we come today and give you thanks for beautiful weather outside right now and for all those who are here. We ask that you would guide the business of this organization as we seek to make a difference in the community around us. We pray this in your name. Amen. Amen.
And you're in luck. I saw Nelson.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to see if you've been teaching them the first person Rotary.
That's all we know.
I asked him to sing the third verse today.
Rotary, that spells Rotary. Rotary is known on land and sea. From north to south, from east to west, the province wants to serve the best. Rotary, that spells Rotary.
Okay. I didn't have any birthdays or anniversaries unless someone wants to point a finger at somebody.
This week.
They're telling on you, Dale.
It is this week.
You guys better have a party for him. That's all.
I'm going to have to figure something out. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and let Johnny come up and induct our newest member and then go ahead and give the sergeant an arms report.
You have his packet?
Yes.
Mr. Smith, will you join me at the front? Wayne? Yes, there he is. All right. Since they didn't provide me with a bibliography. I'd be a bibliographer for you and me, yeah. I'm going to let you tell us a little bit about yourself, your family, what you do, and everything, and I'll do my little thing.
All right.
Step to the mic.
All right. My name's Wayne Smith. I'm from South Mississippi. I came up here to do some work for the hospital, and I'll be here for the next 4 or 5 years. I'm married to my first wife, been married for 42 years to her. If that ever gets over with, I won't do that again. I have three grown daughters, two of them teach school, and one of them works for the hospital in radiology. I have been close to Arkansas. Whenever I graduated high school, I was, you can call it lucky if you'd like to. If I had to do it over again, probably wouldn't do it. I was lucky enough to be drafted by the St. Louis Cardinals, played four years in the St. Louis organization as a pitcher, and found out that wasn't near as much fun as I thought it was going to be, because you only play every 4 or 5 days and you never get to bat. So, and then I went to work in the hospital business. I worked for Singing River Health System on the coast for 35 years. Retired, thought I'd play with grandchildren. Stayed retired for 2 months. I was bored out of my mind. I got yard of the month once, fished all I could fish. So I decided if there was room for an old fat man out there in the revenue cycle business. And since then, I've been to Texas and Tennessee and to Georgia, and now I'm in Arkansas. And I think I might just stay here. It's a pretty nice place. Enjoy being here, and the people are real nice. And I do miss the coast, but the mountains are pretty nice. So that's me.
All right, very good. Well, Wayne, as you've probably heard me say with others, Rotary Club started in 1905 by a young man named Paul Harris and three of his friends who got together to have lunch and fellowship, sort of like we do. And they decided it was such a good idea, but nobody wanted to have it in his office every week, so they just rotated around. As a result, we got hung with the name Rotarians, which is a pretty good way. As you know, our symbol is the cob, and you're an important part of that cob. And that's why we ask everybody to be here every week so that you can participate. And if you're not here, we have a little wheel up here that Madam President says, wheel spinners, come forward. It used to be we had a great big wheel that had money on it. But now this one will have things like do a public service, bring somebody to Rotary. Maybe spend $5 to the foundation, go ahead. So we encourage you to come every week. Even before he became a member, he's been here every week. So his attendance is really good. By 1910, we had 16 Rotary clubs. Now, worldwide, we have 35,000 with 1,000,002 membership. So we've grown a little bit over the years. The four-way test is something we live by, and you know we recite that every week. That was created by a man named Herbert Taylor, 1932. He sort of took the Golden Rule and Ten Commandments and what have you and made them into what we use as a model and as a way to live our lives as Rotarians. It's a good thing to apply to most situations you get into every day. Is it fair to everyone concerned? Will it build good friendship? And all of those things we should consider probably before we open our mouth and say something to someone. That four-way test has been put into over 100 languages worldwide. So if you go to a club in England, you'll hear it spoken very properly. If you go to a club in Japan, you'll hear it in Japanese. I wouldn't understand what they were saying, but you know it's a four-way test. Club service is very important to Rotary worldwide. Our foundation supports efforts in almost every country in the world. We've practically eliminated polio because of the work of the Rotary Foundation. Club service here is important. If you go out in the community and you see things going on and you sort of lift the blanket to see who's doing it, you're probably going to find a Rotarian there. Members, tell him what we do for club service. Anybody know anything?
Scholarships.
Scholarships.
Coach for kids.
Coach for kids.
Best foot forward.
Best foot forward. Dictionary. Literacy programs.
During our Rila this week.
Rila. That's right. And we're taking
how many? Playground equipment.
Playground equipment. Look at this. Just everywhere. We encourage you to get involved in these projects. You'll find that it helps you be a better club member, and you find out a lot of things that's going on in the community that way. Rotary Foundation, I mentioned a little bit ago, started after the Kansas City Convention when Arch Klump, the treasurer of Rotary, had $26.50 left after everything was paid. And he spoke with Mr. Harris and said, we need to do something with this money. And they decided they would start the Rotary Foundation. In the last 50 years, I think it says, we've spent over $3 billion on projects worldwide. The foundation has $1.2 billion in assets. So you're a part of a great organization, a great club. I'm gonna give you your badge to wear each week. If you don't find it in the box, usually we have a greeter, they'll give it to you. But if you don't, I kind of look around the room and I'll go get it. There's a carrying charge if I bring it to you. Here is your packet. It has your new membership ribbon. We ask you to attach it to that and wear it for a few weeks. You see one out there. service above self, the Rotary objectives, the four-way test, and your certificate is in here. Let's give him a warm Rotary welcome. Thought you were going to get away without a story, didn't you? I do a long and a short version. That was the long version today. Short version, when she catches me and I'm not a beggar. Three sons, three brothers, got together for lunch. They were very successful. The first one was a doctor, and he said, "Fellas, you know what I've done for Mother? I've built her a brand new, lovely home." Yeah, we know that. Second brother was a doctor, and he said, first one was a lawyer, by the way. They make the most money. Right?
Oh, yeah, right, yeah.
Second one was a doctor. He said, "Oh, listen, I sent Mother a brand new Mercedes." The other one said, "Well, fellas, you know, that's just fine and good. But you know, Mother is almost blind. And you know how much she loves the Bible." He said, "I found this parrot that can recite the Bible chapter and verse, word for word. All she has to do is ask him and tell him what she wants to hear, and he'll tell it to her." Well, Mother wrote them all a thank you letter. The first one with the big house, she said, "You know, you really shouldn't have done this. I'm old. I only use one room, and I can't keep the rest of this house clean." He said to the second one who gave her the Mercedes, "You know, I appreciate you doing that, but you know I can't drive anymore. And the guy you sent to drive it, he's just rude. I didn't need that car." And she wrote the young man who sent her the parrot the most wonderful letter. She said, "Your brothers gave me these things you couldn't use. I couldn't use, but you gave me the best present of all. That was the best chicken dinner I ever had."
Good one,
John.
No, that's another dentist.
Okay.
You better hope, Ron, that these people that send me jokes love you as much as they do.
Wouldn't I take a break from the jokes?
We probably could. Okay, we've got 25 Rotarians here today and a couple of guests. We have Jared Cook back with us today. He has proposed membership, and we will get that in at our next board meeting next week. We have a couple of high school students. If you don't care, stand up and introduce yourselves, please.
Hi, I'm Lily Dodd. I'm a junior at Batesville High School.
I'm Madison Biddle. I'm a sophomore at Batesville High School.
Welcome. We're glad you're here. Joseph's back with us again this week from the guard. Thank you for coming. Donna has a guest with her today.
It's a familiar face, Justin Laymans. He's our technician at Lion.
Thank you for coming. Okay. Brenda, do you have anything from service?
Just this week, Thursday through Sunday, is our RILA camp for our students. And I want to thank the Rotarians taking them. We've got Max taking them. And then we have Deanna Green's going to be transporting them. And then Donna Cole's bringing them all back. Thank you for doing that.
Thank you. Thank you all. Okay. And Dwight, anything from the treasurer front?
No, just be looking for an invoice maybe this week.
We're into the second quarter. Time for invoices. And those are emailed out. So if you do not get it by email, please let me or Dwight know so that we can get you a hard copy. But you should get those in your email. Okay, thank you. Audrey today was a wonderful door greeter. We appreciate you, Audrey. And next week is Ryan Puckett. You're on deck. Okay, just a couple of quick things. Don't forget about the baseball tickets. We do have to have those mailed into Little Rock by the 24th. So the district has asked that every member try to sell at least two. So please pick up your two tickets from
Barrett and get those. And if you can sell more, that would be great. And remember, the club gets to keep half that money. So that's a pretty, should be a pretty easy fundraiser for us. And then just on a quick side note, I just want to let you all know that John Peek has resigned from the club. He has taken on a greater responsibility, I understand, with Batesville Help and Hope, and he's just not able to make our Monday meetings anymore. So if you see John out, you know, tell him, you know, that we understand, but would love to have him back as soon as he can, is able to be back with us. Okay, with that, I'm going to turn it over to Butch.
Thank you, Amanda. We're happy to have today with us Holly Meyer, our prosecuting attorney for the 16th Judicial District. And I'm going to let her tell you a little bit about her background before a couple of years ago when she got an appointment from Governor Hutchison to be the circuit judge fulfilling Judge John Dan Kemp's remaining 2 years on his term since he was elected to go to the Supreme Court in Little Rock. From all reports, she did a bang-up job as a circuit judge. This year, I think of her as our new prosecutor, 3 months, and she was appointed by Governor Hutchison to fulfill Don McSpadden's term as prosecutor. Don was elected to one of our circuit judgeships, so he's moved over to the judge's office. She's taken over the prosecutor's office and has a prosecuting background. So she's doing a great job as a prosecutor. You can read the Batesville Daily Guard and listen to KWOC News, and you can understand why. Appreciate her taking time out of her busy schedule today to come say hello to us. The first time I met Holly, she may remember this, didn't know her. It was in Stone County Municipal Court, which is misdemeanor court, back in the 90s. And she had just moved up here from, I think, the Little Rock area, or maybe she had been over to Cleveland County, I'm not sure. But anyway, that was back in my deputy prosecuting days. And there was a case before Judge Nevada Richardson in Mountain View. And Nevada, bless her heart, good lady, was a prosecutor's dream. I mean, she was going to lean toward the prosecution regardless. But I don't remember anything about the case, but we had some hearing, and I didn't know Holly from Adam. And so I made my little closing spiel and sat down, and the next thing I know, she gets my attention, and my eyes probably get a little bit bigger and bigger. She's up on the table, making part of her closing argument to Judge Richardson. No jury, mind you. She might have been trying to impress the courtroom, or she might have thought that would help her defendant. Why? I don't know. But it was different. The only time I've ever seen that in municipal court. And it made an impression, let me put it that way. So she will do a very good job as your prosecutor. Holly Meyer.
But I actually don't remember that. but I'm sure if I was on the table, I had something that I felt just had to be said. So thank you for having me. My name is Holly Meyer. I am your prosecuting attorney here in the 16th Judicial District. That's 5 counties. They put Independence County together with Fulton, Izard, Stone, and Cleburne to make a 5-county district. Now that's a really big district. To travel from, you know, the Missouri line down to Quitman, Arkansas is about a 2.5-hour drive, so I'm putting lots of miles on my car. We have 7 deputy prosecutors and myself for 8 lawyers total in the office. We cover a district court in every county. We also cover a circuit court in every county for major felony cases. We also cover juvenile courts, which is a circuit court in every county. And we cover mental commitments in our probate courts, and we cover asset forfeitures in our civil courts. So between all that, we've got probably 12 judges we're keeping track of, and quite a number of courts, and so we stay very, very busy. Since I've become the prosecutor, I've kind of brought my personality and my priorities and some of the priorities that have been shared with me from the public to the office. So let me tell you a little bit about myself and my background, and we'll talk about the things that I'm trying to make priorities during my term here. I was the deputy prosecutor in Stone County for 10 years under Don McSpadden. I was the deputy prosecutor in Cleveland County for 5 years. Before that, I was in private practice. I also spent some time working for the 2 years working for the Department of Human Services during the time of welfare reform. Helped the governor's prepare and pass our welfare reform legislation here. Before that, I was the senior prosecutor in Pulaski County, where I did the homicides mostly. So basically, I've been a career prosecutor. You may have seen recently one of the cases that I prosecuted back in 1993 is one of the 8 cases that's presently set for the imposition of the death penalty coming up on April 20th. So I got to go to the clemency hearing on that just last week. So when you've been, you have to have been doing it for 25 years to have been in it long enough to actually see one of those cases come to fruition or come close to fruition. As I look at Independence County and this district and try to assess what are the problems, and I certainly don't have the answers to all the problems, but clearly drugs are a very serious problem in this area. It's one of the reasons that it is so important as a prosecutor to stay vigilant on this is because it's destroying families. And you can see that from top to bottom, kids at school, families at home, the number of DHS cases and kids we're working. Drugs are destroying families. Now, unfortunately, we have such a plethora of drugs, and what the drug of choice is always changing. We had marijuana, and then when they started testing for marijuana in some of our drug courts, they moved to K2. And then they went to spice, and then they went, you know, there's always a new drug of choice. It was crack cocaine for a while, it was cocaine for a while, and it was meth. Now we're starting to see heroin cases sneak into Independence County. So it's an ever-changing area. But sentencing in the state of Arkansas used to be entirely up to the prosecutor. So Barrett would be the defense attorney and I'd be the prosecutor, and we'd say, well, we think this case is worth this, and we'd try to negotiate it out. If we couldn't negotiate it out, we'd have a trial. But there wasn't a lot of guidance given to the prosecutors on what the sentence should be. So the prosecutor got to use their discretion in thinking who are the bad guys and what the appropriate crime would be. Well, the prisons got so full in the 80s and in the 90s that they had to figure out a way to even it out so that we didn't have all the bad people from one county filling up the jail so the other counties couldn't get their guys in. So the legislature did something called the grid. And the grid is just it's literally a grid. On the x-axis is the number of prior felony convictions you have. And on the y-axis is the seriousness of the crime that you have. So now, if you commit a residential burglary, that's a level 6 on the y-axis, and you've got 3 prior felonies, that's over 3. You go over on the grid, you come to a point, and that's what the recommended sentence should be. So they've taken a lot of the discretion out of prosecuting by putting this grid in place. But that's only a recommended sentence. And this is one of the places that an assertive prosecutor can make a difference. And knowing what the prior felony convictions are and saying, I want to go beyond the recommendation because there's these aggravating factors that exist. You did it in front of the school, or you had your kids in the car when you did it. Those kind of things. Or perhaps there are mitigating circumstances that you should get something a little less than what's on that grid. Perhaps that there are, you know, extenuating circumstances. And so sentencing now has become, this grid is now a tool. It's become part of the negotiations. But one of the things that I've asked all my deputy prosecutors to do is to assure me that on every case where drugs are sold, that someone goes to jail. Now, that seems kind of common sense, but let me tell you, it's not, because on the grid, the first time you sell drugs, and maybe even the second time you sell drugs, this includes methamphetamine, they recommend that you get probation, not that you get any jail time. So my office has said across the board, if you sell drugs, I don't want you to get more time for shoplifting, for goodness sakes, than you would for selling drugs. That's absurd. So I have asked all of my deputies to enforce that, you know, different people, maybe different amounts of time in jail, but in every case where drugs are sold, there will be jail time. A couple of other big things, I want to talk about some of the things that are happening in criminal law and prosecution right now, and then I'll open it up for questions. Marijuana is coming. When the voters of Arkansas voted to bring in this new wave that we're going to start seeing in the fall of medical marijuana. They opened a lot of doors. There's going to be a lot of unintended consequences for this policy. Marijuana is already extremely common. If you've got kids in high school, your kids have seen it in their schools. It's out there. And so when the police pull over a car, as common as cigarettes now, it's just about to find a little bit of marijuana in the car. It's become extremely common. That's going to become more so. And the marijuana that we're seeing is extremely high-grade marijuana. This isn't the stuff that's being grown. This isn't Ozark Frost, the stuff that they're growing in the national forest. This is high-grade, hydroponic, greenhouse grown and fertilized, genetically improved marijuana. The difference is that is the difference between I'm trying to think of a good analogy here. The difference between one hydrocodone and 30 hydrocodones. You know, you don't know what is in there because there's not an FDA label that comes with it. Says this is how stout the marijuana you're smoking today is. Marijuana doesn't just come in cigarettes anymore. It comes in butter. It's like almost like a honey texture, and it comes in wax. And if you go to a paraphernalia shop nowadays, it's not the old pipe that you used to see. Now there's vaporizers. There's much more sophisticated ways to ingest THC. And the reason why is because it's coming in such powerful and potent doses. So as you see medical marijuana coming in, it is not the marijuana that your brother, because I know none of you did it, were smoking in high school. It is not that same marijuana. It is a very, very different product that you're going to see is going to be here. It's, of course, it's very difficult to regulate. You'll start seeing it in food products. And if you are interested in what it does to criminal justice, you can look at the statistics in Colorado. And Colorado is having a very difficult time controlling the unintended consequences of the recreational use of marijuana. Now, I understand Arkansas didn't go all the way to recreational, but you have to understand it's the slippery slope. Driving fatalities are up 60%. There are a great number of crime statistics that have been seriously impacted by the advent of marijuana. I won't spend any more time on that, but that is coming to Arkansas. So you can expect there will be big changes there. Another thing that we've seen in the last 5 years in criminal justice is the advent of specialty courts. And that is where, and typically these are generated from the AOC, which is the Administrative Office of the Courts. And that's really the group of folks in Little Rock that work with the Supreme Court, kind of make some policy decisions on how are we going to attack these problems. Independence County has the DWI court, and many of you probably know Judge Taylor and are familiar with his DWI court program. But the idea being there that throwing you in jail for a couple days and giving you a fine, and you come back 2 weeks later and you've got another one, throwing you in jail for a few more days, giving you a bigger fine, you know, we can just incarcerate you, we can fine you, but we're not solving the alcoholism or the underlying problems. And so it's a kind of that blend between social work and punitive criminal justice to try to get that real solutions. These specialty courts are funded by the state. They take a prosecutor's time, they take a public defender's time, they take a judge's time, so we put a lot of resources into them. And there's varying degrees of success. But the bottom line being, we can't put everybody in the penitentiary. We simply cannot afford it. Now, remember when I told you we had a grid now to try to even out who's going to the penitentiary? Well, jail populations and managing jail populations continue to be an issue. It cost us $45 a day to keep somebody down here in the county jail. It cost $80 plus a day to keep somebody, don't quote me on that statistic because I don't know if that's exactly right, but you know, double that to keep somebody in the penitentiary. So we've got to figure out cost-effective ways. We already have more people incarcerated in the United States of America than any other country in the world. More people per capita are incarcerated right here in the USA than anywhere else in the world. There's drug court, which I think has had some success. And drug court is a court for people that want to solve the problem. If you don't want to solve the problem, it doesn't take very long for the probation officers to catch you cheating on your drug test, and then you end up being thrown in jail anyway. But it does provide a much heightened level of service. We have something called Hope Court, we have something called Veterans Court, we have something called Swift Court. These are all different courts designed to give a specialty level of service, and they're usually a blend of social work and punitive justice, criminal imposition of sanctions, trying to get to solutions. Because obviously, you know, we want you to get out of jail, we want you to get a job, we want you to pay taxes, we want you to support your family, we want you to do the things you're supposed to be doing. And if we're not solving the problem, it's the revolving door. So I think that in this day of political correctness, that people are being more and more conscious of not just lock them up, throw away the key, but trying to solve the problems. And since I've been doing this for 25 years, you'll know that I came up during a time that it was we just lock them up, throw away the key. We don't need to solve their problems. But that approach is what overpopulated prisons, and we really have to save those prison beds for violent crimes, for repeat offenders, for people we need to get off the streets. Now, let me talk about some other priorities. I've hired a victim assistance coordinator in the office. It is the purpose of a victim assistance coordinator to make contact with the victims of violent crime and hold their hand through the criminal justice system. So let's take an example of someone who has been the victim of an aggravated robbery, for instance. So the police come in and they take your statements and they work up the case file and they tell you, you know, we hope you're okay, and they walk out and they send the prosecutor's office the file. And the victim's kind of left there with, well, what's next? Well, the purpose of the victim assistance coordinator is to reach out to that person and say, hey, you're going to be a witness in this case. You were the victim in this case. Did you have any medical bills? The Attorney General's office has a Crime Victims Reparation Fund. Let us help you show you how to access those funds. Let me tell you about what's going to happen criminal justice-wise at the plea and arraignment. What about all these pretrial hearings that we're going to have, sometimes called omnibus hearings? What's going to happen at those? Let me describe for you the plea negotiation process. Let me describe for you what happens if they're put on probation, what happens if they're given a regional correctional facility, or if they're given penitentiary. There's really three levels of punishment that we typically see in these cases. Arkansas law has now enshrined the fact that victims actually have rights. For the longest time, you heard people say, oh, victims don't have any rights. Well, the Arkansas legislature has said, yes, victims do have rights, and they've been very specific about them. If you see something called Marcy's Law, it is a nationwide trend to try to give victims very specific rights that they can stand on. For instance, victims in Arkansas have the right to understand the things that I'm telling you, what happens at each phase of the process. They have a right to be present in court. They have a right to be notified of any disposition of their case. They have a right to have no penalty imposed on them by an employer if they are subpoenaed into court to assist in a criminal justice matter. They have a right to parole notifications. So it's important, especially in National Crime Victims Rights Week, which it is this very week, to remind people that victims have specific statutory rights that are assured to them. And my victim assistance coordinator and my prosecutor's office wants to be sure, because we represent all the people of Arkansas, but we especially represent the victims of crime. And so I want the victims of, in this district, have someone that they can call, they can ask questions to, that they can get someone who's responsive that will answer their questions and hold their hand through what can be a very difficult process. Let me talk for a moment and I'll throw up questions about the legislature. Are they going home yet, Mary?
Not yet.
Okay. We're hopeful, though.
Yes.
Okay. The legislature is trying to solve some of the problems of prison overcrowding. And there's something called the Emergency Powers Act. And when someone is sentenced to jail, they do a percentage of their time. This is part of the closing argument I give in every jury trial. But if you sentence someone to 12 years in prison, they're typically going to serve two. And the remaining time, they'll be on parole. For some offenses, you do a higher percentage, but typically you do 1/6. In some cases, you do 1/4. I'm allowed to tell juries that because of truth in sentencing. But even with that, prisons are overcrowded. Now, what you're seeing, what the police complain about, is the revolving door. You know, so as we put them in, the next week they're back out. Well, the Emergency Powers Act is one reason. The Department of Corrections is so overcrowded right now that before you even do your 1/6, if you get down to your last, say, 100 days, they'll just mark off your last 100 days and let you out under the Emergency Powers Act. they've been doing this consistently for many, many years. So the difficulty about that is I like to shoot people straight. If you're a victim of crime, and if your child's been raped or sexually abused, or your house has been burglarized, I want to say, hey, if I've sent this guy to jail for 10 years, he'll serve X. Unfortunately, the Emergency Powers Act kind of makes a liar out of me, because I can't ever say exactly what he'll serve. I can give you an educated guess, but for someone who's been in the system for 25 years, I can't tell you how long they're going to serve, because Emergency Powers Act. I don't know how long they'll actually serve, when they'll become parole eligible, and when they'll get out. Remember I said there were three levels of punishment. There's the county jail, there's what's called the regional correctional facility, and then there's the Arkansas Department of Corrections. One's the county jail, one's pen time, but there's this thing in the middle called regional correctional facility. And this came up 10, 15 years ago, and the idea was that they put you in prison and they put run you through a series of rehabilitative classes and programs. It was a 9-month, you could be sentenced to up to 2 years, but whether you're sentenced to 1 year, 2 years, even if you have suspended time after that, you must complete a 270 days, basically a 9-month rehabilitative program. You have to take responsibility classes and anger management classes and parenting classes and things to try to solve the problem. It was a step up from probation, but a step down from sending people to the pen. Well, the regional correctional facility has been such a hit and has been so overwhelmed, it's created, you know, they had to make more beds for this, for the regional correctional facility, but they still can't run enough people through fast enough that the Arkansas legislature this term has passed a bill that changes the 9-month, the 270 days, to 6 months. So we're down to 180 days for that same program. So legislatively, sentences are getting shorter and shorter. Methamphetamine, that used to be a Y felony, which was the highest class of felony, which you do at least a quarter of, has now been downgraded if you get over 10 grams, it's a C felony, less than 10 grams. It's a D felony, which is the lowest class of felonies, and that's a big change. So the last legislative session, they didn't completely decriminalize it, but they lowered the punishment for methamphetamine. This criminal justice session, legislative session, they've shortened the period of time in that intermediate prison sanction. So for a country that is already incarcerating more people than ever, we're trying to spin the revolving door a little faster so that we get more people in, because if you don't get people out, you can't get people in. So every day, as a prosecutor, that's a decision that I have to make. Is this person somebody that's worth going to jail for? Because if I put somebody in jail, somebody gets let out of jail, because there is a finite number of beds. And so, has this person done something so heinous that they should go to the pen? Should they be put on probation? Should they have to have a urine test every month? Should they have to have home visits? Should they be on the sex offender registration list? What is the appropriate level of sanctions? Because as a prosecutor, one of the things I'm doing is allocating resources. And so that's one of the important decisions that have to be made every day. I'm trying to work with victims, make them understand the process. To some extent, I want to satisfy them, although when I educate them about some of these things, they don't understand why you can't go to prison forever. So I'm trying to educate people, allocate resources, make good decisions, prosecute cases that matter to these communities, matter to children, matter to families, matter to businesses. So those are some of the roles, some of the things we do with the prosecuting attorney's office, and I would be happy to take any questions from anybody. If you want me to delve into anything more specific, I've just covered a whole lot. Yes, sir.
Do you think we're making any progress at all in the war on drugs?
No, sir, I don't.
What is the answer to that? I mean, what is your theory?
Well, you know, if we wanted to solve the drug problem, we could do some things to solve the drug problem, but our country doesn't have the spine to do it. We haven't invested the resources to do it. We haven't made the penalties appropriate. We haven't shut down the border. It's a game of money, and we have not really had the national fortitude to shut it down. We also haven't had the national fortitude to look at look within ourselves and say, we are the problem. We have the appetite. You know, the reason they serve fried chicken at this restaurant is because we like fried chicken. And the reason that we serve methamphetamine on the streets of Batesville is because we like methamphetamine. So I don't have the answers, but we have to look at decreasing our appetite for drugs as well as making the really hard calls. And we have to do a good job. It's one of the things I try to focus on as a prosecutor, of separating the people that are business people in the drug business, in the drug trade, versus just some poor, toothless fool who's abusing methamphetamine. But I don't think we've dedicated the resources to really solving the problem. I'll give you a good example. I have a drug task force that I met with this morning. I have six agents. We run on about a $200,000 budget annually in these five counties. And a lot of that's federal funds. Those federal funds dry up next year. So unless somebody puts some money into that project, we won't even have an inter-county drug task force. So I'm busy talking to people and trying to figure out how to ways to keep that funding going, because when you're working narcotics cases, narcotics don't stop at the county line, but have no doubt about it. Narcotics in this district come from Batesville. Batesville is the supply. Cleburne, Stone, and Izzard and Fulton are consumers. But largely, especially methamphetamines, comes through Batesville. It's probably not an answer, but that was my thoughts. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Would you say with the increase, you mentioned the revolving door and how it's starting to spin faster, would you say that the increase in that will also increase the repeat offenders out on the streets?
Yes, absolutely. There's no doubt about it. One of the tools that a prosecutor has is to charge people as habitual offenders. It's a special charge, it's not a charge, but it's a special enhancement that we add on to felony informations to say, you know, you've been back to court several times, you have more than one but less than four prior felonies, or you have more than four prior felony convictions, and therefore you deserve a special enhanced sentence. We try to use that tool as much as we can, because there are lots of repeat offenders. There are an enormous number of people on probation and parole in this community. I'm sorry I didn't get that number before, but I'm sure upwards of several thousand people in this community that have either felony convictions, but presently on parole, I would say, which, do you have a sense of that number? Probably close to 1,000 people on parole any time in this community. In fact, that'd be a fair number. Right now, we have 360 cases filed in 2016 at the prosecuting attorney's office. When I left the office today, we filed 110 so far this year, so we're on track to go over 400 cases this year. We're filing, last week we filed 15 D felony, which is the lowest level. We filed a lot of other cases too, but methamphetamine cases. Routine traffic stops routinely have methamphetamine. It is that common. So it is a constant battle. Butch?
Could you share with us what case you worked on in 93 on the death penalty? And then, don't mean to be unfair, but what's your thought about 8 executions in 10 days or whatever it's going to be?
The case that I was the prosecutor on was a gentleman by the name of Liddell Lee. He was the second clemency hearing. He was the second execution set on the first day of executions on April 20th. Liddell Lee was a man who stalks a neighborhood called the Sunnydale neighborhood of Jacksonville. And in 1989, he took a young lady from her house, left her three-year-old child there, murdered her, strangled her, dumped her in an abandoned house. That was in 89. In 90, he raped a young lady and left her for dead, tried to drown her in a puddle behind her house. In 91, he raped a woman next to the railroad tracks in the same neighborhood. In 1992, he raped a 70-year-old woman in her home. And in 1993, he broke into a lady's home and beat her to death with a tire thump, what's called a tire thumper. If you're a truck driver, you're familiar with that tool. The particular gentleman that I prosecuted was a super predator. he was somebody who didn't kill for money. He didn't kill because he had to. He didn't kill for passion. He killed because he enjoyed killing, because he was a hunter. And if you did a map of Jacksonville, you could literally put a push pin. Here's his house. Here's his parents' house. And the push pin of all of his crimes was in his hunting zone. So it is my belief that there is no punishment less than the full measure of punishment which fairly meets the horrific acts that man engaged in. And I believe that the death penalty is, to some extent, society's self-defense. And I do believe, you'll hear different people with opinions on this, I do believe it has a deterrent effect. After 25 years prosecuting in my experience, I believe it does. I think punishment in general has a deterrent effect. Not as great a one as I would like, but there is some effect there. So I'll be going down for that execution on the 20th.
So what do we do to expedite these things so they don't drag out for 25 years of keeping these people in prison and time again appeal and appeal and appeal? And I believe in the appeal process, but it should have a limit.
Well, the appeal process was very quickly expired in that case. The crime happened in 93, the trial was in 95. By 97, the state court appeals were over. After that comes the Rule 37 process, which is where you have a new series of trials about your lawyer being an incompetent idiot, and it's not because you beat somebody to death, it's because your lawyer's a dummy. And then, in this case, that man got two of those hearings. And then you get what's called federal habeas. And the problem with the system is not the appeal system, it is the federal habeas system, in which you get to go to a federal judge and say, in some respect, my constitutional rights were violated by process that this case went through. And here's what I would say to how to fix that problem. You are not entitled to a perfect trial. There is probably not very much in any of our lives that is perfect. You're entitled to a fair trial, but not a perfect trial. And that's what the federal courts seem to have trouble sorting out. Without getting too much into politics, I'm sworn to uphold the Constitution of the State of Arkansas, and that includes the law of the State of Arkansas, which includes the imposition of death penalty when and where appropriate. I choose to pursue that in very rare cases. I'm very selective about that. But the federal courts are the problem in the delays, and the federal judiciary needs to do some soul searching on that topic. Can I take that question? Or can we quit?
We're going to pass time, so okay. You're welcome to talk to her.
I'll be here. I'll be glad to stay and answer your questions.
I was just about to comment. I served on the jury body cam in one of those scheduled for execution. And in the jury room, we said this man will probably outlive some of those jurors. I'm not sure.
Liddell Lee has outlived two of his victims. But his family, who was at the clemency hearing, when I took that case, there was a 7-year-old boy that lost his mother, and that had to go live with other relatives and so forth. At that clemency hearing, that young grew up to be a Jacksonville police officer. And he's now 34 years old. So. All right, well, let me just end on this note. There are a lot of really good people working in the parole system, working in the prosecutor system, even in the public defender system. So although I've talked about problems today that need attention, you also need to know that there are a lot of really terrific people working every single day for justice. Here in Independence County, but probably all over the state of Arkansas. So keep that in mind. If you have any questions, I'd be delighted to answer.
Thank you for coming today. We're going to donate a book to the library, the Independence County Library. It's Tea for Ruby. And inside we've written, this book is donated on behalf of Holly Meyer, prosecuting attorney, for speaking to the Rotary Club at Batesville on April 3rd, 2017. So thank you so much for coming. Okay. Dwight, do you have a ticket for us?
Yes. We had $31, so I guess we'll round it up to $16. I'll let you draw.
Okay.
We are properly licensed.
That's like gambling to me.
We'll go until June 30th.
Okay, 865-961.
That's not me.
Oh!
Okay, does anybody else have anything for Rotary this week? If not, we'll as we always do with the four-way test of the things we think, say, or do. Number one.
Is this the truth?
Number two.
Is this fair to all concerned?
Number three.
Will it build goodwill and better friendships?
And number four.
Beneficial to all concerned.
We're adjourned. Y'all have a good week.